gonna set my heart at ease. Gonna make a sentimental journey to renew old memories. Got my bag, got my reservation. Spent each dime I could afford, like a child in wild anticipation. Long to hear that all aboard. 7, that's the time we leave at 7. I'll be waiting up at heaven, counting every mile of railroad track that takes me back. Never thought my heart could be so yearning. Why did I decide to roam? Gotta take that sentimental journey, sentimental journey home, sentimental journey.
Welcome to the celebration of the life of John Paul Eaton, affectionately known to many of you as Jack. Jack was born on May 27, 1926, to Paul Burns Eaton and Hannah Wilkins Eaton. Jack's father was a professor of machine design and engineering at Lafayette College, and his mother did all the things that a professor's wife did at that time. Jack was a change of life baby, and his birth was difficult. The doctor said he could save one, but probably not both, and asked Professor Eaton whom he wanted saved. My wife, of course, was the answer. But lucky for all of us, both were saved. Jack's academic prowess was evident early on, and his parents, well, they doted on him, as you'll see later. He graduated high school at 16 and enlisted in the Army at the end of World War II. Sentimental Journey was one of his favorite songs. After earning a degree in biology from Lafayette College in 1947, Jack moved to New York City and settled in Greenwich Village, where he embraced the life of a bohemian. He had to support himself, so he found work at NBC Studios as a page and witnessed much of the golden age of live television in the early 1950s and regularly watched the legendary Arturo Toscanini conduct the NBC Symphony Orchestra. One of his favorite memories at that time was he was playing the piano. Unknown, he could be heard by the maestro himself, who tapped him on the shoulder and said, "You're pretty good, kid." So, what was life like for young Jack in New York City? Well, among his things, a few letters from his father were found. First of all, it must have been hot. "Dear Jack, enclosed is a check for $100. Use part of it to get an electric fan. One trick to cool the room is to wet a towel and have the fan play upon it to evaporate the air, thus dissipating the heat in the room. Be sure to get that fan. Dear Jack, enclosed you will find a check for $100 payable to you for having written that letter to us, especially to Mother, who dotes on such things, as you know. Your statement indicating that you are buying a fan indicates semblance of a return to reason, but don't have the breeze blow directly, uppercase, upon you. I kept warning Mother about such a procedure to no avail, and then came that threat of pneumonia. Get that fan and use it properly." Must have been hot in Greenwich Village. Dear Jack, today is February 10th, and your cry of distress, written February 1st, awaited me when I went to the college office this morning at 9 a.m. Crossing in the mail is a check for $100, which you will have received ere this one arrives. And this one will contain a check for $300. What you propose is appearing entirely feasible, for you should protect your own means of living and take this money. There is no groan on my part, and surely not mother's, when basic needs arise. Never has been, and never will be. We are born into this world to help one another, especially when in trouble. So don't you worry about being a drag. Will you be able to take your bed and things like that with you? I hope so, and hence the extra 50. You speak of having to add from one month to another. Okay, but should you need more money, we'll supply it. I noticed that you mentioned clothes recently, and then he goes on about how a well-dressed man will be successful. So we can see Jack certainly knew how to hold his parents up for cash. The address may have been 197 Bleecker Street. What Jack loved about the village all of his New York life was the music that could be heard there, and he made many friends in the cabaret world. One of his dearest friends was Cynthia Crane, whose artistry he adored and whose humor he always got. He used to say, jokingly somewhat, but I knew he was serious and he meant it, were anything to be done for him after he shuffled off this mortal coil, he absolutely wanted Cynthia to sing this song. She can't be with us today, but she did write. First and foremost, I loved Uncle Jack. I always will. He was a gift. Adventurous, witty, smart, his own, special. They spent many times in the village and in Paris. Jack, with his edgy, winking sense of humor, always enjoyed this song written by Jay Leno back in the 1980s. But it's ever closer today. It's called Goodbye, Miami. And she closes, adieu, chère amie, Cynthia.
Carbon monoxide is spewing from cars. Blots out the sun, it blots out the stars, heating the atmosphere so scientists say, and melting the ice caps away. As the ice melts, it is not surprising. The oceans are ever so steadily rising, steadily rising through high tide and low. Florida will be first to go.
Jack had to wear a uniform as a page at NBC Studios, but his fully adult career was as an admitting officer at Roosevelt Hospital, where he spent more than 35 years. He loved what he did there, and it gave him purpose. And because he was a single man, he often worked the holidays so those with families could spend time with their loved ones. Here to speak about the hospital and what it meant is Mercedes Herman.
I was a head nurse in the orthopedic clinic and subspecialties at Roosevelt Hospital. Many of my patients would have to be admitted into the hospital to have some type of surgical procedures. And especially the hand clinic, which was a subspecialty, which usually was, if you didn't have insurance, it was quite costly. But we had beds and we had places where we could find to put those patients. And always who would help us do that would be Mr. Eaton from admitting office. He'd come up and he'd talk to the patient and he'd look at me and say, "Don't worry, Ms. Herman, we'll find him a space, we'll get him a room." And at the time he would just, the calmness about him and the generosity, and people just kind of felt safe with him. Now, one of the other things, sometimes when he couldn't come up, we'd have to send the patients downstairs to the admitting office. And always, if it was children, I loved to send them downstairs because I knew that as he was talking to the parents, the children would be fascinated with all the paraphernalia that he had about the Titanic. And with the little eyes looking at, he would take out time and he would tell them about it. He would just speak to them. And many a times there were parents down who went down with, or a significant other, who knew about the Titanic. And they would have questions and they would say, "You know, I always wondered about this." And then when the movie came out, they were even more like, "Oh, why did this happen?" He always was generous with taking care of the patients and generous with his information. It was a pleasure working with him. And one of the things I also liked about him so much was that whenever we had a party on the floor, Christmas, birthdays, anything, he was such a pleasure to come and, you know, we'd call him down and we'd say, "Come on up, Mr. Eaton. Come on up, we're having lunch, we're having some kind of party or something." And he would come up and he was the type of person that just kind of just blend in and had a good time. And we always would say, "I got cake. I got a really nice piece of cake for you." And we could always kind of, you know, he'd give us a little something about talking about the Titanic. And it was always, he was a Renaissance man. He was a pleasure. He lived a good life and brought a great deal of joy and comfort to people, always letting them know, "Don't worry, we'll find a place for you." And he did. Sometimes I used to wonder how he was able to find a bed for this patient. And he did. He will be sorely missed, not because he's not working. He left the hospital a long time, but that kind of generous spirit, that curiosity, that's what's going to be missed. And the world needs all these good souls. Now he's an ancestor.
I met Jack, as many of you did, as a result of my interest in Titanic. I wrote to him in 1984 with the thought of doing a cassette. That's what we had back in those days, of Titanic-related music. I met the man himself, the dean of Downing Street, in 1987, when I found myself in Greenwich Village. Jack lived on the top floor of an old brick apartment building with no elevator, and it was the heat of summer. I climbed up the stairs and opened the door to find Jack in his empire of books and journals, files and notes and periodicals that went from the floor to the ceiling. He probably had more books than the Library of Congress, but he was very much at home there as a researcher and historian. And he had also the company of some very wonderful felines over the years. I had the honor of meeting Pussy Willow personally. And to Jack, animals were like people in little fur coats. And he very much loved all animals, and particularly cats and dogs. And you'll hear more about Jack the animal lover. He also wrote a book, not about Titanic, but a sort of tongue-in-cheek Julia Childs meets Edward Gorey, called The Disgusting Despicable Cat Cookbook with his friend Julia Kernitz. And this was a side of Jack I did not know. He was a marvelous cook. And it's a very witty, slightly dark cookbook, Things You Can Do with a Cat. This is a side of Jack many of you did not know, I'm sure. He was a wonderful correspondent. I enjoyed many years of writing when we used to sit down with a pen and paper and write. I have kept many of his letters. We shared an interest in the liturgy of the church and the ceremonial, and his letters all began, "Dear Reverend Mother," and they were signed Frère Jacques. So we had a lot of fun with that. If you were lucky enough to be one of Jack's correspondents, you know how original and unique his mind was, and how funny he could be. Jack was also a mentor to many of us, encouraged young people to love history and to challenge oneself to do things that maybe you think you couldn't do as a writer and contributor to the vast knowledge of Titanica. I miss him very much, and I know I'm not alone in that. He was one of a kind, for sure. I miss the way he used to steeple his fingers and lean back and say, "Well," and he was an observant man, observant about everything in life. Also a wonderful listener. To have Jack's ear was a great thing. He gave very sound advice and always encouraged people. He's very positive. Rest well, Jack, until we meet again.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for joining us for this service of remembrance. In July 1946, at age 20, Jack made a routine purchase that would change his life. As he awaited his discharge from the United States Army, he happened to purchase a newsstand copy of Esquire magazine. In it was this story about the sinking of Titanic that included this dramatic rendering by artist Harper Goff. Throughout his life, Jack said it was this painting that ignited his Titanic interest, one that spanned 75 years and culminated with his dive to Titanic's wreck at the bottom of the Atlantic. He began collecting newspaper clippings, Titanic memorabilia, and ocean liner postcards and menus. In September 1955, Walter Lord's groundbreaking book, A Night to Remember, instantly found a place on Jack's bookshelf. He and Walter would become close friends, each serving as an occasional reference source to the other. While employed at the NBC television studios in New York, Jack's Titanic interest grew when he witnessed the dress rehearsal for the television adaptation of Lord's book, broadcast live in March 1956. Jack marveled at the production's complexity, involving 107 actors on 31 studio sets. In 1958, the acclaimed movie version of A Night to Remember hit the silver screens around the world. By the disaster's 50th anniversary in 1962, Jack, now with a keen eye for Titanic detail, had written, and the United States Naval Institute's journal Proceedings had published, his letter correcting an erroneous Titanic caption. He was acknowledged in Jeffrey Marcus's 1969 book, The Maiden Voyage, and John Maxtone Graham's 1972 volume, The Only Way to Cross. He became friends of both authors. Now, he often was spending vacations and many Saturdays at the New York Public Library, digging out new details, reading microfilm newspaper stories, and keeping its copier machine humming. By January 1980, he had achieved a reputation as a serious Titanic researcher. This New York magazine profile noted that his New York apartment was like a mini library for Titanic, steam locomotives, dirigibles, and Boss Tweed. Jack said, "It's the details that fascinate me. They're never going to end. It's like music, and you're constantly adding to them. What was Jack like as a writer? Privately, his letters often were humorous, whimsical, unusual, and just plain fun to read. His writing for publication always was research-based. By the 1980s, he had amassed a huge collection of clippings, personal notes, photocopies, letters, and other documents. Whenever he received an inquiry from the public, he happily dove into what eventually became 4 2-drawer file cabinets and emerged triumphant with the answer. But his research wasn't limited to files, nor to the hundreds of books in his library. Long before the internet made armchair researching possible, he and I visited dozens of cities for in-depth, in-person research. The ultimate research site, of course, was Titanic's wreck, which Jack visited on June 11th, 1993. His encyclopedic knowledge was in constant demand during the 3 Titanic expeditions we shared. Jack's style employed precise vocabulary and multiple phrases and clauses packed with information. He loved action verbs, adjectives, and adverbs that painted vivid imagery. Once he gave me this book as a Christmas present, and I thought, so this is where he gets all those unusual words. Well, fortunately, this was only a typical gag gift from Jack. And as you will hear, it had served him very well in defeating unsuspecting victims at Scrabble games. But his well-thumbed copy of Roget's Thesaurus provided his precise, thoughtful word choices. He was indeed a true wordsmith. For our first 2 books, Jack handwrote his portions of the text, always preferring printing to cursive writing. Then he would type his text on what he called his mighty Olympia typewriter, like this one, which he had found cast lonely and forlorn on a New York City sidewalk. In his early 70s, he grudgingly learned to use and eventually came to love writing directly on his first computer, a lime green Apple iMac. Because our writing styles were different, his was expansionist, mine was concise, we edited one another's texts. He added details to my writing, I pruned excess wording from his. Somehow we achieved a uniform style throughout all our books. I then entered our mutual handiwork into my computer's word processing program for submission to our publisher. Together, we wrote 5 books. 3 achieved 3rd editions, and 1 reached the Times of London's bestseller list. But Jack's writing wasn't confined to books. He was a regular contributor to our Titanic International Society journal, Voyage. Among his diverse writings was a regular column, Profiles of a Disaster, Titanic-related ships, where he presented details of other vessels' direct connections to Titanic, providing each ship's dimensions, a photo, and its entire service history. He discovered and wrote about more than 200 such vessels. Sadly, he put aside his intention to publish this unique research in book form. I will always cherish so many memories of our enduring and unique friendship. Our journeys together, researching and writing our books, discovering previously unknown Titanic information, responding to so many questions, and just spending quality time with one another. I lack the words to thank you, my dear friend, for nearly a half century of wonderful experiences and for your understanding, guidance, humor, love, and encouragement. Over the years, Jack shared information and friendships with so many people around the world. Now, several of these friends wish to share how Jack touched their lives through Titanic.
Hi, everyone. I was a co-leader with George Tulloch of a 5 expedition to the Titanic site between 1987 and 1998. I also led an expedition in 2010 and was a member of the last expedition in 2019. For the first time, I met Jack and his friend Charlie Haas at the Titanic site in 1993. Jack did his first dive on June 11 that year on board the submersible Nautil. It was a 9-hour dive, and Jack spent 6 hours and 25 minutes on the bottom at the depth of 12,500 feet. Most of his dive was on the bow section of the ship. His job was to comment on his dive. Later, on board the Nautil, the mothership, Nadir, and it was one of my best memories of Jack, when I listened to Jack dive, I laughed, and I will never forget what he was saying every 10 seconds between his comments. He said maybe 100 times, "Oh my God," each time he saw something new. Jack studied carefully all the parts he visited, including the Captain Smith's room, the grand staircase, and using the little remote operative vehicle, the Robin, he visited for the first time the 3 cargo holds of the bow section. It was a great dive. He always gave us a lot of information about the ship and the artifacts we recovered. His vast knowledge of the ship was a big help for the artifacts exhibition RMS Titanic Inc. did for almost the last 3 decades. With Charlie, Jack told me everything about the ship, the passenger, and the crew. Jack was always in a good mood and joking. It was really a pleasure to work with him. Jack, we are missing you. Thank you very much.
I was one of the co-founders of the Titanic International Society, and Jack Eaton was our historian. I knew Jack for several years prior to the organization coming into existence, because we had a mutual interest not only in the ship, but certain aspects of the ship, including collecting postcards about the Titanic and the other ships that were involved in the Titanic story. Over the years, I got to know Jack personally and also as a remarkable historian, a wealth of knowledge, and any idea that I had to advance the knowledge base about the Titanic story, I knew I could count on Jack for reliable information as well as accurate information. We did a project about the role of the Salvation Army in New York, managing the survivors coming in off the Carpathia. And that led to a project that brought the one of the Titanic survivors to Ellis Island. And it was during that time that we were able to present to the National Park Service a plaque dedicated to the Dream of Freedom for those persons, not only on Titanic, but other ships that lost their lives while they were coming to America, who never actually fulfilled their dream of freedom. That plaque is on permanent display at Ellis Island in New York. We moved on to another project, and this one was more interesting. Well, they were all interesting. This one looked at the 5 postal workers that were on board the Titanic, and we were able to identify not only the postal workers, but we found more information about their personal lives and their role as far as what they did on board the Titanic. Now, the National Postal Museum, which is part of the Smithsonian Institute, became extremely interested in this project. And from that project, the Smithsonian Institute now has an online exhibit called Posted Aboard the Titanic. And it was a remarkable event to be in Washington, D.C. to tell the postal worker's story and to present a plaque to the United States Postal Service National Postal Museum, recognizing the work of the five postal workers who all died in the line of duty. Probably the most impressive project that Jack and I and others worked on was in 1999, when we recognized the loss of the 53 children on board Titanic, who just were separated from their families, and just horrible, horrible story, and the emotional component of that story. We did this in Halifax, Nova Scotia, and Fairview Cemetery, right at the site of the monument of the unknown child. The program was so powerful. The Canadian Broadcasting Company had televised this project live across the entire country of Canada and also the Pacific Northwest. Jack was instrumental in providing a lot of the cultural background on all of the children from all of the countries that they came from. And it was during this time that, you know, I really had a chance to let it sink in as far as how knowledgeable this man was with just these four projects that I was involved with. And I knew of the other projects he was involved with. Jack was truly a remarkable individual, a very bright man, a very friendly man, who was willing to share his knowledge. And his publications and his presentations around the world have been well received. And it's just, it's sad that we lost a wonderful historian, but the legacy lives on. And I am proud to call Jack a friend, proud to call him a fellow historian. And I hope somewhere along the line, you will get a chance to read some of his work and to see some of the projects that he brought to fruition through the organization. So my dear friend, Jack, I love you. I miss you. Your memory is with me, and the projects that we did together are burnt in my soul. And I appreciate everything you've done for me. So God bless you, and rest in peace, my friend. And so sad, but a wonderful, wonderful man.
When I think of my friend, John Jack Eaton, my friendship with Jack goes back, well, almost 40 years, when I was just 11 or 12 years old, back in 1983. I became very interested in the Titanic story at a very young age, and even at that young age of 10, 11, 12, I started researching, which was back then with no internet, and it really involved just going to a local library. And when I learned about, there was a book called The Night to Remember, and after reading that book, I became familiar with a society called the Titanic Historical Society, and I had contacted them, and I remember being so interested that I wrote to the then president of that society, Charles Haas, of my interest, and Mr. Haas responded, and he was very, very kind, and he told me about a convention that was to be happening in Philadelphia in 1982. So at that time, I attended with my family the 1982 convention of the Titanic Historical Society in Philadelphia, and there I met Mr. Haas, as we know as Charlie today, and Mr. Eaton, Jack. And it was then that I became acquainted with them. And I have to say, I think because of my interest being so strong, which I think they recognized, I started writing to them even after the convention. And both Charlie and Jack were extremely forthcoming, with information. They were only too happy to share with someone who was very young. As I say, at the time, I was just almost a teenager. And I was really in awe of just how generous they were with their information and their knowledge. I mean, I can't even go into the number of times, you know, how both Jack and Charlie, but especially Jack, because he was the historian, he used to always send back then by regular mail copies of accounts from some of the survivors, because my particular area of interest in the Titanic subject was the people. And, you know, of course, the survivors were of particular interest to me. And Jack always, usually once a week, there was a letter in the mailbox that had, you know, an account from an old newspaper from 1912 or one of the anniversaries. And the thing that I really remembered was that Jack was such a teacher and a mentor, and he was so patient. And he, I think, appreciated the enthusiasm that I had as such a young person to be so interested in such a subject. And he was just so willing to share his mind with what he knew. And I'll always be grateful for that. And I'll never forget the opportunity that I had to spend quite a few weekends with Jack and Charlie down at the National Archives in then Bayonne, New Jersey, where a lot of the records from the Titanic court hearings were held. And I didn't realize how fortunate I was to be present when Jack and Charlie invited me to join them to help catalog some of the material and to index some of the claims that were there. I just didn't appreciate the significance of just how important that research trip was, because when I saw Jack's impression when we got to the National Archives and they wheeled out these carts of boxes of material, and I saw Jack's expression, and here was a man who had studied the Titanic for for decades and was a very well-respected, you know, historian. This was all new information that was in front of him. And I'll just never forget the expression on his face and some of the few choice words that he used in his reaction to the material, which really was, you know, quite remarkable. This collection had never been seen, I think, up to that time. And I just remember how fortunate I was to really be there with Jack and to have him sort of, you know, walk through some of the, to give a lot of commentary, you know, on a lot of what we were seeing. And it was just amazing. His mind was just an encyclopedia of knowledge. And I have to say, I always cherish that in all the years of our friendship. It was always, you know, if there was ever a question, you could go to Jack. And I'll never forget, you know, just how patient he was and how kind he was to share his wealth of knowledge. And I'll always remember that about Jack and all those trips that we made, whether it be to Bayonne, to the National Archives, or overseas to the United Kingdom, to Southampton, to a lot of the research trips that we made. And like I said, it was just such a wonderful experience to have known Jack. And I will dearly miss him and all of the friendly exchanges of information. He was always so courteous to always share any passenger related material with me. And I will certainly miss that. And I will always cherish the friendship that I had with Mr. Eaton, Jack. And, you know, I'll never forget him.
I was so sad to hear of Jack's death earlier this year. And I thought when the first time we met was quite a long time ago, in 1985, when he and Charlie came to Southampton when they were researching their classic book, Titanic, Triumphant Tragedy. And I had the privilege of having a few photographs included in that book. And it's remained a classic ever since. I don't think it's been out of print, or it shouldn't be. But dear old Jack, I think the last time I met him was quite a few years ago now, on the 1996 expedition to lift the big piece from the Titanic out in the North Atlantic. Jack's hearing wasn't too good by then, and I'd started to chat to him, and he invited me to go into his left ear because he could always hear me better in that. But he always treated me like a long lost friend, which was rather special. Jack was always very generous in his help with my own projects, in the loan of postcards, of the slide to postcards, in information, brochures, and so on. And I'll always be grateful to him. I've been in touch with my friends in Europe and in Sweden, asked them for their remembrances of Jack, and I've got one or two here. If I'm Sweden, the coming came, one of the most knowledgeable Titanic historians that there was. From the Isle of Jersey, somebody started their interest in Titanic by buying the Triumph and Tragedy for 34 years. And the reader has written her own articles ever since. Always enjoyed seeing Jack and Charlie giving their lectures. And she says, Jack's knowledge and enthusiasm for the subject and his generosity in passing it on was immeasurable. And I literally owe the hobby that has taken up most of my adult life to him. So people remember Jack with great fondness and great warmth. And another writer said, those remember his chuckling. And at the British Titanic Society meetings, he usually went to bed early, but always remembered his chuckles. So personally, I owe a great debt of thanks to Jack, and his memory will always burn bright in my memory. So thank you, Jack, and good night, old man.
I am president of Titanic Society of Atlantic Canada. I consider Jack a friend and an inspiration. During my years as a Titanic researcher and amateur historian, I was honored to meet Jack in October 1998 when he visited Halifax with Charlie Haas, fellow Titanic researcher, co-author, and Jack's dear friend, for the launch of Titanic, Triumph and Tragedy, second edition. I had the opportunity to meet Jack and Charlie again in April 2007 during a convention hosted in Halifax by Titanic International Society, or TIS, commemorating the 95th anniversary of the Titanic tragedy. It was wonderful to speak with and learn from them. I garnered much information from their presentation. Jack and Charlie visited Halifax for the first time in 1982, and through their very detailed account of the many aspects of Halifax's role in the Titanic recovery effort, they brought the history to light for the world in 1983. This included information about the 150 graves of those who perished and are buried in Fairview Lawn, Mount Olivet, and Baron de Hirsch cemeteries, with details about many who rest there. From conversations within the Titanic community in Atlantic Canada, I can attest that Jack was very well revered as a historian, researcher, and co-founder of TIS. Jack was a big influence on Titanic researchers, enthusiasts, and those newly introduced and interested in the Titanic story. Jack and his books are referenced often. Conversations with him are remembered fondly. Fellow members of Titanic Society of Atlantic Canada knew Jack for many years, and some met him at the 2007 convention. Jack was very much missed during the joint TIS TSAC convention held in Halifax in June 2018, as he was not able to travel. In 2020, Charlie frequently updated me on Jack's health, and I corresponded with Jack via cards through postmail. On Jack's passing, members of TSAC shared with me that Jack was a font of knowledge. He may have been the oldest to travel to the Titanic wreck site. Jack had a very humble and nice way of doing business. He was very willing to share his knowledge and to introduce newcomers to the field. I have a humorous story to share. Dr. Henriette Mann, a member of both TIS and TSAC, who is a biogeochemist, was working in 1996 at St. Mary's University. She had discovered the new bacteria from Titanic's rusticles, but did not have results yet. When the results were published in the Chronicle Herald, Jack and Charlie tracked her down and told her they would be visiting Halifax in the next few months. She met with them at St. Mary's. Their visit was before supper, and they talked for about 2 hours. She showed them a PowerPoint presentation, including a slide of the rusticles. Jack then said, "That's it? Can we eat?" She replied, "Do you want to eat the rusticles?" Jack started to laugh. Charlie responded, "No, regular food." That was the beginning of their very long-standing friendship. To me, Jack was a true gentleman and a very caring person. I miss him dearly.
I was a very good friend of Jack Eaton's for 35 years. Jack and I met in 1987 when he and his best friend and writing partner, Charlie Haas, who were co-founders of the Titanic International Society, became great friends with my late husband, George. I have so many wonderful memories of Jack, it is very hard to recall them all. We shared special moments, including artifact exhibit openings, the first one being in Greenwich, England at the National Maritime Museum in 1994. We also shared many moments at Titanic conventions, including the international event in 2011 in Belfast, Ireland, where Jack celebrated his 85th birthday. There were special times at sea in 1996 aboard the Island Breeze and in 1998 aboard the Ocean Voyager, where our team recovered the piece of the hull known as the Big Piece. It was there that we encountered two life-threatening hurricanes, Bonnie and Danielle. In April of 2012, we were together again, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the sinking of the Titanic aboard the ship, the Balmoral. It was there on this ship that Jack did lectures every day and people were fascinated by his knowledge. Over the last 10 years, I was fortunate enough to spend many times with Jack at his home in Cold Spring, New York, and at his nursing home in Mohegan Lake, New York, where he last celebrated one of his last birthdays, his 93rd. Jack, I will miss you, and I know the Titanic will always miss you.
All the while, Jack was writing about the Titanic and diving on the wreck. He was working at Roosevelt Hospital. He refused to retire because Roosevelt Hospital, which all of Jack's working life had been on 59th Street and 9th Avenue, had just built its new facility on 59th Street and 10th Avenue. And Jack was determined to work in the new office for a couple of years. He was still on the sixth floor at 53 Downing Street, the only remaining tenant in a building that the landlord had let fallen into disrepair. The roof was leaking, there was no heat, And around that time, I adopted a dog called Dexter and decided it would be great if Jack could move out of the city. And so coinciding with his retirement, we found a house up the Hudson River in Cold Spring, a block from the train station, and a walkable village, perfect for someone who didn't drive. And Dexter, that dog, that magnificent Vizsla Ridgeback, was Jack's entree into village life. Now, in the Cold Spring Garden, there was a stone wall, and above it, the sky at which at sunset was magnificent, silhouetted against a picket fence. And Jack loved spending the evenings in the garden. And then a few years later, the land was sold and a New York City architect built a house that essentially was a beach house and would have been appropriate on Fire Island, not a quaint village up the Hudson. And for 2 years, Jack fumed about Jody, the architect, and her lawyer husband, Christy, those weekend carpetbaggers. He was less alike. Now, that picket fence. When we bought the house, our clothesline was attached to it. And after years of city laundromats, Jack liked his laundry flapping in the breeze. We had not met Jody or Christy because they were New Yorkers. 2 years went by, and sure enough, one evening, Jack is startled to see they are coming up the steps and knocking at the door. Jack answers, not quite sure what they wanted. They ask Jack if he could move his clothesline now. Imagine Jack taking those dramatic pauses of his, two beats. I'll move my clothesline, he finally said, when you move your house. And he slammed the door. Now, the marvelous thing about this was the sweatshirt he happened to be wearing, practice random acts of kindness. We laughed about that for years. But Jack decided he wanted to make sure a blight such as Jody's house never happened again in Cold Spring. He joined the planning board and brought to civic duty his sense of, shall we say, proportion. When I started directing local theater, I was fortunate enough to direct a play called Lettuce and Lovage. Maggie Smith had starred on it in Broadway. It's about a tour guide of a stately English manor house who makes up the history to entertain herself. And the opening of the play is a long monologue in which the actress playing Lettuce is interrupted by a character billed only as the surly man. Who better in the role than John Paul Eaton? And here to tell us about his acting ability, my Lettuce, Nancy Swan.
A few years ago, Ryan cast me and Jack in his production of Lettuce and Lovage up at the Falls Theater. And I was really excited about the part. And I was looking forward to working with Jack. He was an actor, but it was a perfect role for him. And I was playing Lettuce. And the beginning of the play, she's giving tours of this very boring historical house. And she sees that the tours aren't going very well and people are kind of bored. So every time you see her, she's added a little more to the story. It's a little bit more fanciful, a little more exciting. And it progresses to becoming quite a story by the fourth monologue. So one thing about this piece is that the monologues are very similar. And if you're not really careful, you could get into a little bit of a loop because it could take you from one to the other if you're not paying attention. So one night, I was going through the play and the first monologue went well and the second one, but I got to the third one and I slipped into the fourth monologue. And I realized it, and I'm thinking, oh my God, how am I going to get out of this? I have no idea how to get out of this. And I'm looking around at everyone on stage, and everyone's looking at me like, and I was starting to panic. And then suddenly, I hear Jack say, excuse me, which was his line. And I say, what? And he says, got it right here. Could you give me your reference for that story? And suddenly, everything was back online. Jack saved my butt. And I'll forever be thankful for that moment. He's a dear guy, and I miss him.
Jack had a fall just before he turned 80 and could no longer walk Dexter. So I put an ad in the Putnam County News and Recorder looking for a dog walker. And when young Greg called to ask if the position were still available and tell me all about his dog, Jazzy, I told him to come on down to meet Dexter and Jack. And the next day he arrived with his father, mother, and 9-year-old brother, Stephen, the Casement family. And for 15 years, they loved and treated Jack as one of their own.
I've known Jack since 2003-2004, back when I was in middle school, and I answered an ad in the local PCNR paper in Cold Spring looking for a dog walker. At this time, Jack had fallen, cracked his head open, and was spending quite a deal of time in the hospital. Jack miraculously came through, came home, and came into our lives. My life, my brother's life, Stephen, and lives of my parents. And he became a part of the family. Jack would spend most Easters, most Christmases with us, enjoying the good conversation, chatting, reliving the good old days when grandparents were in town. These memories I share with him are the most vivid when it comes to the conversations, like they probably are for most of you. Jack's wealth of knowledge and experience and eagerness to learn and grow and talk and be was very prevalent, and he showed that to me, and we shared that together. So much so in a lot of late night conversations after train rides back from the city, pop off of the train, you know, dip up to Railroad Ave, and the conversations would go, whether they were solo, whether they were with a girlfriend at the time. And those conversations would go everywhere, from music and art and culture to relationships, to politics, to anything you can think of. And I would argue strongly that there was a period in my life, a few years, where Jack probably knew, saw, heard me more than anybody else in my life. And that simply came from his eagerness to want to know, to want to learn, to want to hear, to want to get to better know me. And he gave me the benefit of the doubt and his ear like very few people did. And I will forever be grateful for him and the relationship and the time that we got to share together. We had a little love-hate fun relationship with sports. As you guys know, Jack was a Mets fan and I was a Yankees fan. Rightfully so. And I would usually log off a phone call or visits by, you know, saying go Yankees, where he would usually respond with a fuck the Yankees and give his little chuckle, half smirk, and followed by the yo. So Jack, this one's for you. Made me think of you. Hope you guys enjoy. I'm an old man now, can't do nothing. Young folks don't pay me no mind. But in my days, I sure was something. Before I felt the heavy hand. I'm an old man now, bound for glory. had enough of this old world of worry. Gonna trade my troubles for a crown. Now I'm gonna make my way across the fields of cotton and wade through muddy waters one last time. But in my dreams, I come out clean when I reach the other side, west of where the sun sets. Where rainbows never die. I've got one last thing to do, one more mile before I'm through, casting off these earthly chains, going where there's no more pain. I'm gonna make my way across a field of cotton, wet through muddy waters one last time. But in my dreams, I come out clean when I reach the other side, west of where the sun sets, where rainbows never die. Where rainbows never die. I'm an old man now, bound for glory. Time to lay these burdens down. Love you, Jack. Go Yankees.
I first met Jack when I was a middle schooler, about eighth grade. I was just Stephen Casement, taken over from my brother Greg as the dog walker for one of Jack's best friends and soon to be one of my own, Dexter. And I remember at the time just being very nervous to meet Jack. This was a job I'd never done, a man I'd never met. But it didn't take me long to realize that I didn't have to be nervous, not with Jack. And that I was soon gaining not just a friend in Dexter as man's best friend, but in Jack as well. And I quickly connected with him. He would tell me stories of his Titanic ventures and his studies, and it fascinated me as an eighth grader who had at that point already decided I wanted to be a history teacher. And here I am 12 years later, a doctoral candidate in European history, and I think back to some of the stories that have fascinated me most in history, and they always bring me back to that love seat in Jack's living room, sitting next to him, listening to his stories and his fascinations with history that meant that history wasn't just important to him, but it was important to everybody, and I wanted to be part of that everybody. Jack and I would talk about the Titanic, we'd talk about English history, now my own field, we'd talk about shared literary interests from Shakespeare to the Sherlock Holmes stories, both in written and televised form. And he'd talk about life in Cold Spring, which he always seemed to know everything about. Everybody knew Jack, everybody knew Dexter, and I was thrilled to be part of that everybody that got to know him. He would join our family for Christmas and for Easter, for holidays, and we found ourselves to be the luckiest family in Cold Spring because of it. Jack was the living embodiment of what it meant to grow up in a friendly, wonderful, loving village like Cold Spring. And he was kind, he was corny, and above all, he was always so very supportive of me and the whole Casement family. And for that, I will always remember him.
I get out, not you. I think when we were diving on the wreck, and we came down, I'd say, half a mile from the wreck, and we began scooting along the bottom. It looked just like a beach. And pretty soon you see something dark. And as you go along these little dark pieces, suddenly coalesce and suddenly through the porthole directly ahead is a wall stretching across, and you slow down and stop and creep up on it 1 inch at a time, and pretty soon you see that it's a piece of metal with rivets in it. And you suddenly realize that's it. That you're looking at it. That is Titanic. That's it, to see Titanic and realize for the first time that it is Titanic, I guess, is about the high spot of my 60 years or more studying the wreck, is seeing it and realizing that it is Titanic.
Wow.
Hey!
Must be powerful.
I do not want to dive again. It's changed since I was down. And I don't want to see it falling apart. I saw Captain Smith's bathtub. Actually saw it in place. It's all been ripped apart now and gone. But seeing that big black wall and realizing that it was Titanic, that's about it.
The first time that I met John, I went into the room that he was in and introduced myself and told him that I was his aide and asked him what he would like me to call him. He said that his friends called him Jack, but being that my name was Jill, it was much easier if I stuck with John, so I did. He told me about writing books about the Titanic, and I said, well, that's fascinating because my birthday is April 10th, which is the day the Titanic set sail. And John said, well, then it's destiny that brought us together. And from that, our friendship started. John had grown a special fondness for room 18 because it had a window that looked out onto these trees. And one tree in particular had loads of animals running through it all the time. And he picked up an interest in bird watching. And he would call me just to tell me that, you know, oh, look, my cat's back and stuff like that. And I think it brought him a lot of peace. And so no matter what happened, no matter where John was, we would work really hard to get him back into room 18 so he would have that view. And, you know, spring has started and it reminds me of the days, you know, once it would get warm enough, even though John was always cold, I'd put on like 2-3 layers and take him out to the patio to read, but not before he snuck a little baggie of peanut butter filled M&Ms under his book so that he could go out and read and then fall asleep under the trees. And it's funny because John at the beginning was on a pureed diet, and he said to the speech therapist, "Listen, I've been feeding myself for over 90 years and I know what I'm doing." So basically he said that he wasn't about to give up his daily dose of chocolate and that he'd quicker go choking on chocolate than living on Jell-O for the rest of his life. And we discussed lots of things, his love of the Mets and opera and birds and Big Bang Theory. When COVID started, I got him a mask for the Big Bang Theory. And he told me lots of stories. I had given him a Mets blanket and he kept it on his bed all the time. He insisted that I make his bed and put the Mets blanket on top. And it had to be a particular way on the bed. I even went to the point where I was able to track down a copy of his old cat cookbook. And he was delighted because he said that Charles knew, he really didn't like that book. And he just thought it was so delightful to read through it again. And it was funny listening to him giggle through it. Eventually they moved him to the residential wing. And I would go over on Thursday afternoons after I clocked out to pursue our Scrabble games that we played every Thursday afternoon. And John would, when we were playing Scrabble, it was like an adventure. He would, "my dear," "my love," throughout the whole game. And then if I challenged a word of his, he'd say, "well, mother would have accepted that word." And I said, "well, I'm not mother." And luckily, because of technology, I had a Scrabble dictionary close by. And sometimes he would get upset and he'd say, "well, I lost because of my age." And what's funny is anyone who knows John knows that age did not really take its toll on his mind. I played liaison for John's last birthday because he had COVID and he was on another wing and that wing did not get very good reception. So I videotaped him opening his presents and he got a lot of chocolate. And he was like a little kid. I gave a picture to Charlie of him looking so delighted in his gifts. And it was really nice. And he kept those chocolates. There were special chocolates that he hadn't had in a while. And he would give one to people and he would tell them how to eat it to really cherish the taste. I would start each workday with John ringing the bell and I'd go in and there'd be like a little wave with his hand by his side and his head still turned to the pillow with his eyes closed. And he would say, "is Trump still president?" And I'd say, "yes." And he'd say, "well, then I'm going back to bed." And basically we would argue about when he was gonna get up because it was, he didn't like going and walking and stuff like that. And it wasn't until he started walking with the walker that I realized how tall John was. I never realized because he sleeps like in a fetal position and all scrunched up under his Mets blanket. And I could never tell how he was so tall. It was amazing to me. He made such progress and he had such a sense of humor and it was a joy to know him. And every roommate he went through had a special liking to him. There was no way for them not to. I also played liaison at John's last Christmas because he awoke very early and he didn't want to wait to open his gifts. He put on a special t-shirt and hat that Ryan had dropped off the day before and insisted that he wear it for Christmas. And he looked absolutely adorable in it. And I can still picture him in it. Actually, I have a picture of him in that outfit because he just glowed, absolutely glowed. And I thought it fitting that most often John was in room 18 because it stands for life in Hebrew, which John was full of. He was full of life and love and joy. And we grew to be very dear friends. And even when I was caring for him and I fell and broke my ribs against the dresser, he stood up immediately and yelled at me to sit down in the chair. And he would not, he followed me to reception to make sure they were going to take care of me. And they said that I had to call him because he would not rest until he had heard from me directly that I was okay. And it was priceless. It was one of those things about him, the relationship that we had that was so special. Every time I would come back from a day off, he would have this smile on his face, like as if I'd been gone for a month. He was so happy at the end. And what was amazing to me was he had finally stopped talking about going home, which was so sad all along because he just really wanted to go home and they could not get enough of an aide for him. They couldn't get someone that would last, enough hours. And John had this habit of, you know, if he wanted to get up, he would get up. And toward the end, he was, you know, we were going through a pandemic and with all the limitations that it put on us, he still had his phone calls and his window visits. And he took up watching the Harry Potter series of movies on TV and still educating people on birds and the Titanic. It was wonderful. I mean, everyone referred to him as my guy. If he wasn't in the mood to take his pills, they'd say, go tell your guy to take his pills, or they'd give me the pills and bring them to him. He was very happy. He was very much at peace and it was nice. He had a routine and he had a roommate that he really got along with, and he was surrounded by aides and nurses and therapists that absolutely cherished him and he cherished them. And it was nice to see him so happy finally and not restless about wanting to go home. And it was a nice peaceful existence and he had come to enjoy being at our place. He just didn't enjoy that people couldn't actually come in to say hello and he had to talk to his friends out the window. But in all honesty, you really can't ask for more than the fact that someone you love is happy in their existence. And so that's how I'll think of John. Jack, is that he was happy at the end and he was at peace with his existence.
Please remember him. I'll leave you with a biblical passage from St. Paul. Finally, brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All God's people here send their greetings. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Rest well, Jack.
Jack's love of music intersected with his Titanic fascination. He was deeply interested in the ship's orchestra, its music, and its members' heroic deaths. One enduring puzzle involved the final piece they performed just minutes before the end. By almost all accounts, from 1912 onward, it was Nearer My God to Thee. But which setting or tune of this hymn was played that night? The 1958 film A Night to Remember had used the tune Horbury, while the 1953 American film Titanic and James Cameron's 1997 epic, also titled Titanic, had used the tune Bethany. In his usual fashion, Jack began digging through multiple, often obscure sources and found 8 different tunes for that hymn. He collected his evidence. Titanic's bandmaster, Wallace Hartley, was a Methodist. His father was choir master at the Bethel Independent Methodist Church in his hometown of Colne, Lancashire. The church's hymnals contained Nearer My God to Thee in the tune Propior Deo, or Closer to God. It was written by Sir Arthur Sullivan of Gilbert and Sullivan fame. This famous pair were among Jack's favorite composers. In our book, Titanic Destination Disaster, Jack wrote, quote, "The New Music Review, August 1912, suggests that Arthur Sullivan's Propior Deo was likely the hymn tune used by Hartley. This setting was played at Hartley's funeral. It was known to have been Hartley's favorite hymn. Indeed, when asked by one of his colleagues while serving in the liner Mauritania's band, Hartley stated that if he were aboard a sinking ship, he would assemble his men and play O God, Our Help in Ages Past, or Nearer My God to Thee, since both were his favorites. And it was the hymn played at the graveside of all departed brothers of the Musicians' Union," unquote. Indeed, Hartley's colleague told reporters, quote, "When I speak of Nearer My God to Thee, I mean Sullivan's setting. That would be what the orchestra played on the sinking Titanic," unquote. And the opening notes of Sullivan's setting appear on Wallace Hartley's gravestone, approved by his family. Jack was confident that the version we are about to hear surely was the setting of Nearer My God to Thee, as played by Wallace Hartley and his heroic colleagues. We offer it now as a tribute to our dear friend.
love.